Whenever things got rough, I always remember what my father used to say.
Running a business does test a man, my son. There are ups and downs. Glorious highs, and sometimes a low that leaves you feeling defeated.
The character of a man and the character of a business are not very different, are they?
Yes. But when the chips are down, we must stand up, dust ourselves off, and motor on.
Volatility. It's a funny thing. It makes you question yourself and wonder if you've made all the right decisions.
Sure, you can question some of your decisions, but stay steadfast on your goals.
Dad always said, there are no shortcuts and no quick profits.
There are no free lunches, are there? There is only one.
Right way.
At PPFAS, we think like Rahul and his father, that volatility is a fact of running a business. And buying equity shares is like owning a part of that business. We use value investing principles to manage your money. This means we invest in the right businesses at reasonable prices and for a longer term.
PPFAS Mutual Fund. There's only one right way.
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme related documents carefully.
Good evening. For a while now, Mehul has been complaining that the topics have become too boring. So, what's all this, all the time finance and all that? So, I thought today we'll talk about food instead of finance. And depending on how things go, maybe a little bit about sex as well. So that's the topic today, and obviously I couldn't mention it in the email, so that's how we are here. We'll discuss a few starters. You have these lovely paneer tikkas of, you can see various colors. So some of you may know that there are varieties of paneer tikka. You have achari, you have kali mirch, you have malai. Here you can see different kinds of paneer tikkas, one with the achari reddish orange base, you have the green base, plus you have pineapple and tomato pieces with nice fudina chutney and some onions. These of course are, as you would know, hara bhara kebabs with nicely roasted cashews put on it, and with the and this is something of a fusion starter, where some soy base with besan and this vada kind of thing. This, it's baked, it's on the healthier side, so for people who want healthier starters, this is it, with some special kind of dip that you see on the side. And for people on the non-healthy variety, with the traditional samosas, cocktail samosas with tangy imli chutney. Coming to the main course, we could go in for Amritsari chole with the traditional spices that come from the North India. Vegetable jalfrezi, yellow nice tadka dal on the side, and people especially in Gujarat and some people in Maharashtra have sweet dish as part of the main course itself. So you could have the lovely saffron rajbhog, which is something like a rasagulla but with fillings of nuts and with saffron chashni and pistachios that you can see on the top, and again you have a variety of Bengali sweet on the right hand side, and finally when you finish it you can wind up with a nice big bowl of ice cream sundae. You can see some nuts and cherries and chocolate sauce and all that, and after such a sumptuous heavy meal, if you are feeling drowsy at the end of it, you can wind up with a cup of mocha at the end of it. So, anyone's mouth is watering in the audience? Yes? No? Yes? And if we had not had the snack earlier, we could have written off the remaining part of the talk today, right? We could have, our mind would have been completely taken over by food. So, all of you know, right, this is just a screen where some light color is being thrown on it. This is not food that you can reach out to, grab it and put it in the mouth, right? We know that. These are just images. It's not food served. You can't even smell it. So why is the mouth watering? So in whether in traditional Indian philosophy or medicine or in the Western medicine even today, it's a well-known fact that the mind plays a very big role on the body. If you are angry, your heart rate goes up, your cheeks redden, breathing pace increases. It's well known. Similarly, in Western medicine, it has been found out that if you give a pill without any active ingredient in it and you give it to someone and say that this will cure you, that immediately in most people starts giving positive effects. That is something called the placebo effect. Same way, our minds were thinking about food, so our body reacted by activating the salivary glands in our mouth. So it is well known, there's nothing new that I have told you, that your mind affects your body. This again is known by people that the body also affects the mind. Again, yoga practitioners, vipassana practitioners know this. Let us say you are very agitated. You consciously try to slow your breathing and you focus your attention on your breath. Immediately the mind starts calming down, your pulse rate, heartbeat rate, everything starts coming down, blood pressure comes down. So the body also has a very big impact on the mind. So essentially, the body and the mind are our own creations. Both are one in a sense. It's very difficult to separate out the two. It's very difficult to separate out the body and the mind, and very difficult to say where one starts and where the other ends, or vice versa. So we have heard Paragbhai over many, many years talk about behavioral finance. And for those who are not very familiar with it, with the subject, behavioral finance talks about the human aspect of finance. It does not assume the rational human being that we encounter in economics all the time. It looks at all the errors that human beings are prone to while taking financial decisions. So these could be things like the sunk cost fallacy, where you have put in some money into some investment or a venture, and even though it is not working out, you find it difficult to recognize the loss and write it off, or you keep pumping in more money into it. Or the framing effect, where depending on how opportunity is portrayed, people will choose option A or option B, whereas both may be equivalent. So behavioral finance talks about all those things. It talks about the various heuristics and biases that we have. Heuristics are shortcuts that the mind takes while taking financial decisions. These shortcuts may not be in our financial best interest. So that's where behavioral finance comes in, and it's been a huge advance for economics and for the field of investing as compared to the traditional finance theory that a lot of us have studied in curriculum. And although this has not been explicitly said by behavioral finance textbooks or by anyone, the assumption is that when we know about behavioral finance, we will keep that in mind when we do our financial transactions. So we will be better off in terms of dealing with finances because of the knowledge of behavioral finance. Again, in behavioral finance, we have seen how we go through cycles of greed and fear. When everyone is greedy, people ignore the risk, bid up things to whatever level, feel jealous about their neighbors making a lot of money, blindly go and buy the dot-com stock, or blindly go and buy the infrastructure or real estate stock if that is doing well. And fear in 2008-09, if prices are crashing, you go into a shell. Either you sell off all your investments or you say, I don't want to put in any more money, even though the time is appropriate. So we go through these cycles of greed and fear. So recently I read this book called The R Between the Dog and the Wolf. Ignore the title, it doesn't have much to do with what we'll be talking today. This book has a very intriguing premise, and we'll look at what that premise is. If what the author is speculating, if that is correct, then knowledge of behavioral finance will only go part of the way. There are some additional steps that we will have to consider to act in our own financial best interest, and we'll see what those are. So, coming to the topic of today, apart from food, it's the physiology of finance. It's not the psychology of finance, it's the physiology of finance, meaning how our body reacts with finance. We have seen how the mind reacts with finance in behavioral finance and psychology of finance. So this is, in other words, behavioral finance on steroids. So before we dive into it, this is probably one of the very few or one of the only books out there which talks about this subject. It's very new. A lot of things that are being spoken about are hypotheses or assumptions. They need to be validated over the years by research, additional research and all. Not to say that there's no research behind this, but it's a developing field. So essentially we'll raise a lot of questions and let's see what answers we get at the end of it. So this author, John Coates, he worked on Wall Street for 12 years. He's someone who understands finance. He's not a complete academician in that sense. He was a PhD from one of the universities. Then he quit his Wall Street career, went back to college, studied various things in biology, and then came back to a trading desk in London and did his research on this subject. So what is the methodology that was followed in terms of trying to understand the physiology of finance? One is, he saw financial markets in action, and he was someone who understood financial markets. Second is observing behavior of people on the trading desk. third thing is looking at behavior of various species of the animal kingdom, monkeys, elephants, rats, doing experiments on those animals. And finally, essentially taking blood, urine samples of traders at various times during the dealing day and looking at biological markers, blood pressure, blood sugar, heart rate, pulse rate, maybe they are the same, but cortisol level, various biological markers, adrenaline. So based on this methodology, he has proposed certain things. So in behavioral finance, we've seen how we talk about greed and fear. So equivalent of greed and fear in physiology of finance, what we are saying is there is euphoria or a mania, and equivalent to fear, there is enormous amount of stress and there is depression. So it may seem like hair splitting or nitpicking. Instead of one word, you are replacing some other word. What's the significance of this? The significance lies in the second half, mania and depression. Mania and depression are clinical conditions. They are not a state of the mind. They are conditions where the patient or the person suffering from those conditions loses complete ability of thinking straight or coming out of it. Then you require medication, you require intervention by medical professionals. So that's the difference between the two terminologies. So euphoria and stress is the early part of it, non-clinical version, and later on there's a clinical version of the same condition. So we come to this question of, is there free will? If we know that these are the heuristics, these are the biases we are subject to, can we out of our own free will overcome those biases? So I'll just play a short video and then we'll discuss this further. Thank you. So I don't need to explain what was happening here, right? Everyone got what was happening? A guy who was most likely under the influence of alcohol went to the parking lot and tried to take out the car. Now, if this guy, his brain says, willpower, you are going to drive straight. You are not going to get into any accidents. Can that willpower work? No, because his body is flush with that chemical, ethanol, which is not allowing the brain and the mind to drive properly. So in this case, obviously there's a disablement of free will to drive the car. So if your driver came after having a cup of coffee, you would happily give the keys of the car to that driver. But if that driver has had half a bottle of whiskey, then obviously he's not in a fit condition to drive. We all know this. There's again nothing new that I am talking about. But the question is, do we require alcohol or drug consumption for an altered mind-body kind of situation? Does this loss of will or loss of free will happen only when we are under influence of alcohol or otherwise also? Any thoughts? It can happen elsewhere. Any examples? Yeah. If someone ticks you off the wrong way. I'm sure most of us, if not all of us, have had this experience whereby someone irritates us, we say something harsh, that person in turn says something harsh, we say something harsher, that cycle keeps building up, and you either have a verbal fight or in some extreme cases a physical fight. And when you look back on that incident after 1 day, 2 days, 3 days, you are surprised, why did I act the way I acted at that point in time? So obviously at that moment, you were not in control of your own self or emotions. So again, we'll just take a quick look at
this is the moment a rampaging elephant flips a car carrying two tourists. The massive bull first crushed the front of the hatchback before rolling the car with astonishing ease. The terrifying attack was captured in South Africa's Kruger National Park 2 weeks ago, but has only just been released.
They're gonna die.
A female passenger had to be rushed to hospital with a gore wound to her upper thigh, but has since been discharged. According to a spokesman for the Kruger National Park, the male elephant was in a state of heightened sexual tension known as must, making it extremely aggressive. It has since been shot and killed.
So this was the sixth part. I forgot to tell you it was animal sex and not human sex. It was elephants. So elephants, when it's the most vivid example, when elephants reach that stage of adolescence or whatever equivalent of puberty in humans, the male elephant many a times becomes uncontrollable. They can break very strong physical barriers and they can wreak havoc on even people who are taking care of them, people who have been feeding them since childhood. They could even kill those people when they are agitated. So sometimes these, we have seen the example of human rage, or we have seen the example of an elephant. Sometimes these mind and body altering chemicals are generated in our own body. We don't have to ingest them like alcohol or like drugs for us to lose control over what we are trying to do. So the book is for someone who's not from the biological field, it's a bit tedious. So I'll try and keep it as light as possible, but we can't avoid some terms, and we'll go through some of the basic terminology that is there. So this word we have come across even in our normal language, normal interactions, hormones. So hormones are nothing but chemical entities which send messages from the body to the brain and vice versa. So a hormone could tell your brain that I am hungry, or I am full now, I am thirsty, I am satiated now, I am feeling sleepy, or I am short of breath, there is less of oxygen, or it's very hot, or it's very cold. These kind of messages keep going from the body to the brain and vice versa through the mechanism of hormones in the body. And sometimes if there is a hormone imbalance, it has effect on the body. So if your body is not sending a message to the brain that I am full and I am not hungry anymore, you will keep eating, and it will result in various conditions, maybe obesity or something like that. However, there is a separate class of hormones called steroids. Now these steroids are extremely powerful. These are not just messengers, but they are extremely powerful messengers, and they can alter various things in the body simultaneously. So that's why the use of steroids is regulated in a very tight manner. Athletes are not permitted to use steroids to build up their performance. So people who are fighting for, let's say, an Olympic medal, they are tested whether they are on steroids or not. So steroids simultaneously will affect your growth pattern, your body metabolism, shape, mood, memory. They affect all of these things at the same time. So they are a special class of hormones which need to be used with caution, or if they are there in the body, one has to figure out what is to be done about it. So as regards the first thing, which is we looked at euphoria and mania, that is essentially caused by these two things, dopamine and testosterone. These are the two entities which are governing euphoria. Then we looked at stress and depression and things like that. Those are governed by adrenaline and cortisol. We will look at a specific type of nervous system, or we'll briefly discuss it, which is called the vagus nerves or the vagal break in the body. Now the interesting thing about our brain, or if you just reflect on this, that plants do not have any brain like animals have, right? Plants have the seed, trunk, branches, leaves. There's no specific brain in plants. There is a special type of a species of animal, maybe a marine animal, where it is born with a brain. It hunts for food or a good feeding ground. The animal reaches that feeding ground and then consumes its own brain, because then after that it doesn't have to move for the rest of its life. So it reaches there and consumes its own brain. So a lot of biologists are hypothesizing that the purpose of brain in animals and in human beings is motion, to move from one place to the other, or to do physical actions like lifting a book or eating or whatever actions that we do. So we'll keep this at the back of our mind when we discuss some of the things down the line. Again, a large part of the book talks about gut reactions or instantaneous reactions. And this is very relevant for traders, people who are sitting in the front of the screen or who are on the phone all the time and who have to take quick buy-sell decisions. I'll not be discussing much of this in our talk today because we are looking at it from the investment point of view where we don't require instant decisions. But just to cover it in maybe one slide, this slide itself, is that let's say there's a close-in fielder in a cricket match. That person does not have time to see that a ball has been hit, it's moving towards me at this pace, it will go in this direction, I have to jump there and I have to stretch my hand. There's no time for conscious thought. The fielder moves by reflex, whether it's a football goalkeeper, whether it's a close-in fielder in cricket, or any sport, a tennis player, they work on reflexes. There's no time for conscious thought. And similarly, many traders work on reflexes. So, quite a bit of the book is on traders. So, we'll not cover that part today. We'll look at the remaining part which affects us as investors. So let's look at euphoria or the greed equivalent in humans. So as we mentioned, there are these two chemical entities or types of hormones and steroids which lead us to euphoria. So dopamine is something which gives us pleasure. That chemical is linked to the body feeling pleasure in whatever activities that we do. And if for some reason the body is not able to produce dopamine, even a pleasing activity which is done by you will not result in the mind feeling any pleasure. So this is the entity which is responsible for pleasure. So it's basically the body mechanism is such that whenever you do any activity which is contributing towards your positivity, meaning good health or survival or whatever, then the body will reward you for that activity by giving you a dose of dopamine. So these are the activities essentially which result in dopamine. So the last part, earning a lot of money, helps you with other things, helps you to buy more food, more drink, whatever. So the ironical part is that when animals have been tested and they were given dopamine for free, meaning you get injected with dopamine, you don't have to eat food to have dopamine, the animals lost all interest in eating. They would go on consuming dopamine and starve themselves to death. Rats. So, when this becomes excessive, people lose interest in some other things. And we have seen this in humans too, right? So, all recreational drugs, things like alcohol, cocaine and various other types of drugs, they increase the proportion of dopamine in the body, and people who are addicts lose interest in everything else except for getting that quick hit from that drug. So from the baseline, let's say currently we are doing nothing, there would be some amount of dopamine in the body. If you have food, it would increase by 50% over baseline. Sex, 100%. Nicotine, which is tobacco, 200% over baseline. Cocaine, 400%. Some other drug, 1000%. So basically, all these drugs give you a large amount of dopamine, in short. So dopamine, the interesting part is that over a period of time, the body gets habituated to certain things. So if a certain amount of drug was giving you a certain amount of pleasure, over a period of time, that pleasure keeps going down. You have to increase the dosage of drug to get the same amount of dopamine. So why is this relevant to us? What does this have got to do with finance? So let's say someone is a pauper, has no money at all. That person goes to a gambling den and wins 1000 rupees on the first day. It will give that person enormous amount of happiness, enormous amount of dopamine for that 1000 rupees. Let's say he continues to do that for 1 week, 10 days, 15 days. Over a period of time, the body will get habituated to that 1000 rupee level. Then that 1000 rupee will not give him equivalent pleasure by that gambling win. Then he has to increase the bet. The gambling win has to be at a level of 2000 rupees to be able to get the same amount of pleasure from that activity. So this is where the higher amount of risk taking comes in over a period of time. It has been seen in gamblers. The author is saying this applies also to traders, the financial traders who operate in the financial markets. Yeah, we mentioned that over a period of time, the response is diminishing. If you are used to a certain activity, that same activity will not give you the same amount of pleasure all the time. That pleasure will go on reducing with that activity. We saw this, how rage goes into a increasing feedback loop. This happens also with money making. When people make more and more money, the confidence keeps increasing and people want to increase the amount of bets that they place on the financial markets. So the dopamine is a short acting entity. Testosterone is the longer range chemical. And again, some people may have heard about this thing called testosterone. It's not just a chemical which is there in males. It is there in females as well. But the proportion in males is far larger. So it's almost as much as 10 times in males as it is in females. And it is not just linked to sexual activity. It has got linked to do with various pleasure related activities, making money. It works in conjunction with dopamine for other food or drink or something like that. And we mentioned how they were taking blood samples. So this guy actually took blood samples at various points in time during the day, and there was a clear correlation between the amount of testosterone in the bloodstream of a trader and that person's profit and loss account. So if that person was on a profit run, you could clearly see the increase in testosterone levels over a period of time. And if that person was making losses, then that level would go on declining in that person over a period of time. So how do we cure euphoria? How do we guard against euphoria? So one of the general techniques I'll discuss later on, when we discuss depression as well, we'll combine euphoria and depression. But basically it says is get older people in. Very young people are much more susceptible to these wild swings. So when you have people who have seen a few cycles, or again, this guy is completely into the biology frame of mind. He says that typically young males, or in males there is a cycle, birth, then adolescence, adolescence to early youth, there is a high testosterone cycle, and later years it's lower. So older people are less prone to euphoria as compared to males in their 20s to 30, 35, that kind of age. This needs to be tested out, but according to the author, fewer women got taken in by the dot-com euphoria or things like that. So one of the recommendations the author makes is to employ more women into the investment management trading roles as compared to men, because men are prone to blowing up financial institutions far too often. Yeah, and employ, apart from supervisors, generally employ older people as traders and investors rather than give too much power and too much responsibility to younger people.
In that earlier slide, you can add FOF also.
You might reduce our attendance. People will think that coming here has some unwanted side effects. So we discussed in the earlier slide that purpose of the brain is physical action. So that is relevant to this slide here. On the left hand side is a lion, a kind of predator we would encounter if we were living in the jungle in the olden times. On the right hand side is a crashing financial market, which causes us financial loss. Both these events cause stress to us as humans. However, the body's reaction to this event as well as to that event is exactly the same. Whereas in the second event, you don't require to run away from a lion. You can't run away from the screen and avoid a loss, right? If you have taken a position. However, the body will prime, the mind and the body complex will prime you to have a fight or flight response, even in the modern era. So what happens when we have stress? And this has, these reactions are observed in human beings as well as in animals. So a deer who is going to be eaten up by a lion will have the exact same reactions. So whenever we are undergoing stress, heart rate goes up, that is one. Blood pressure goes up. Blood sugar rises. Why does it rise? Because you require more energy to be burnt in a short span of time to run away or to fight. Why does heart rate go up? Because you need to carry more oxygen to various parts of the body to fight or to run away. Sweating, because whenever you are running, body temperature will go up. Sweating will bring down body temperature, will control the body temperature. Whenever animals are fighting, if they are furry animals, their fur will stand on their ends. So they want to appear larger to the opponent, and for that they will raise their fur. But we have the same reaction. Our hair will stand up, or if we don't have hair, we'll get goosebumps on our hands if we are under stress. And in extreme cases, people pass urine and stool. So the logic behind that is, if your body has less of urine and stool to store, your body is lighter. It helps you to run faster. So none of these things will help you in terms of meeting financial risk. All of these are helpful only in terms of fighting or running away from a predator. Still, our body reaction is exactly the same today. And when, again, this response, so if you are running away from the lion, how long do you think you will need to be in stress? 5 minutes, 10 minutes, half an hour, 1 hour. In that time, either you will manage to successfully run away or you will get eaten up, one of the two. You don't have to remain in that stressful situation forever. However, if you are in the financial markets, 2008-9 happens, how long will you be in that stressful situation? You will be in it for days, weeks, months, years maybe. So, all our stress response which the body has, it's designed to be short acting. It's not designed to be long acting. So actually, when people are under stress and when you are running away from a lion, for example, your body will shut down digestion. That is, energy is precious. Don't waste it on digestion. Don't waste it on growth. So when you are trying to survive, it doesn't matter whether your height is increasing or not. Right now you want to run away and survive. So put growth on back burner. Don't worry about storing energy in terms of fat. Just consume what you have right now. There's no time to think about sex or reproduction. You are running away. You are trying to survive. It doesn't matter whether your immunity is high or not. A virus or bacteria will kill you longer term. Right now the lion is here and now. So immune system also does not get enough resources from the body. What matters is only this. What matters is survival. This is supposed to be for a period of 15 minutes, half an hour, 1 hour. It's not designed to run on a days, weeks, months kind of basis. What happens when we have stress for days, weeks, months at a stretch? That's when this entity called cortisol runs amok in our nerves and gives us all the metabolic disorders, hypertension, heart disease, diabetes, blood pressure, blood cholesterol. All of these are somewhere linked to high levels of cortisol in the blood. And that's why people in very stressful roles, either in financial markets or in politics or in business, tend to suffer these consequences. So what are the things which cause stress? One is the situation that you are facing. You should be facing it very rarely, if at all. If it's a very familiar situation, you typically don't get stressed by that situation. Yeah, it's demonetization came after a long time. So it was a novel situation for people. There should be uncertainty of what will be the outcome. If the outcome is known, then there's not too much stress. And you should have no control over how things will pan out. So if someone else is in control or if things are completely random, it will cause more amount of stress. People who have done any amount of weight training will know this, that you don't pump the weight every day of the week for the same muscle group. Essentially, if you have done biceps today, then next round of biceps will be maybe next week. After undergoing that amount of stress, you have to give a period for recovery, for the muscle to grow back or to grow bigger than what it was. And then again you give some amount of stress. So whether on a physical basis or whether on a mental basis, the body is not designed for continuous inflow of either dopamine, testosterone or adrenaline, cortisol. It is designed to have these only as short acting hormones in our body, and as soon as their function is over, they should go back and not agitate us all the time. So whatever works, whether restricting the hours you look at stock prices or check financial news or taking a break periodically in terms of vacation or taking a midweek break in terms of doing a different kind of activity. So whatever works for different people, but one has to break the cycle. If the cycle is not broken, if the either the euphoria or the stress continues for a long period of time uninterrupted, then it can develop into clinical situations like a mania or like a depression. And something like a depression has nothing to do with whether you are rich or not, whether you are successful or not. It's a clinical condition. So sometime back you would have read about Deepika Padukone giving interviews that she underwent depression and then came out of it. Or many a times we hear about very successful people killing themselves on account of depression, or sometimes we see young people in love harming themselves. Again, it's that the body completely takes over. The rational mind does not have any space left to have its say. So mild amount of euphoria or mild amount of stress is good. It energizes us, it prompts us to seek out new opportunities or to control our risk. Uncontrolled things of either of them play havoc with our bodies and even with our finances. So this is what we had to discuss today. I guess by now you will appreciate why the topic was not sent in advance. Very difficult to explain this in an email. We'll be happy to take any questions that you have.
Whenever things got rough, I always remember what my father used to say.
Running a business does test a man, my son. There are ups and downs. Glorious highs, and sometimes a low that leaves you feeling defeated.
The character of a man and the character of a business are not very different, are they?
Yes. But when the chips are down, we must stand up, dust ourselves off, and motor on.
Volatility. It's a funny thing. It makes you question yourself and wonder if you've made all the right decisions.
Sure, you can question some of your decisions, but stay steadfast on your goals.
Dad always said, there are no shortcuts and no quick profits.
There are no free lunches, are there? There is only one
right way.
At PPFAS, we think like Rahul and his father, that volatility is a fact of running a business. And buying equity shares is like owning a part of that business. We use value investing principles to manage your money. This means we invest in the right businesses at reasonable prices and for a longer term.
PPFAS Mutual Fund. There's only one right way.
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme-related documents carefully.